So we're going to have some fun today. A lot of times we have these programs and we give you a laundry list of gift vehicles, then you're expected to go home and use them and don't get a lot of context around certain things. So what we want to do today is match up those gifts vehicles with the different stages of the donor. It appears that younger adults, more entrepreneurial, not as concerned with tax implications as their counterparts. Donors in midlife are more concerned about tax avoidance, and older donors more concerned about a legacy. So just to briefly refresh, and that's all I'm going to do is name the charitable vehicles. Let's start off with the smallest, with a donor advised fund. Funds go in, go out to a number of charities. Which requires a trust document, a CRT, Charitable Remainder Trust, then Charitable Lead Trust, or a private foundation. So what I want to do, instead of stealing all the thunder, we can come back and summarize the different generations, but we've defined three generations. We picked three out of the many today to discuss: millennials, baby boomers, and then what I'm just going to call seniors. You can use any ages. You can have any age you want in any one of those things, as far as I'm concerned. So let me start with Mike. You do a lot of work with Next Generation. How do millennials approach philanthropy, and what have you seen is important to them?
Great. Well, good morning, everyone. Nice to be here with all of you. So I wanted to start, I think, by first maybe going a little bit back on what you said. Just, I will define millennials.
That one you could define. You won't insult anyone with that one.
I didn't think I would. just so we sort of know what we're talking about. So millennials, there's no very clear agreement. People disagree on some of the years. But basically we're talking about people who were born between the early 1980s and the early 2000s. And just for context, there's about 76 million of them. So it's a very big generation. It's, in fact, currently the largest generation. I don't know how much I can tell you that is completely new today. This is probably the most studied generation in history. Philanthropic. I mean, there's been so much interest and research into their behaviors and their interests. I will do my best to give you something new. And I do want to also note that within 76 million people, there's a lot of differences. So anytime we're talking about generations, I think we're talking to some extent. All right. I'll probably be quieter with the microphone. We're talking a little bit in generalizations.
Okay. I really have to be quieter when I'm speaking into a microphone. I thought one thing that I would do just to give us a little bit of context to get started is to get us a little bit into the mindset of millennials. So it's really hard. I'm sure you all have seen this in your work. I certainly see it in mine, that actually there are some real differences generationally in terms of life experience, in terms of how we experience the world. And it's really difficult as an advisor to always put ourselves in the mindset of a different generation. So let's do that for a moment. So Beloit College actually does this great list every year for their incoming classes. They call it the mindset list, and it's about 50 things that sort of describe life since this class has arrived on the planet. So this is the most recent one. It's from the class of 2020. And I thought I would just share a couple of these things with you. So number one, Vladimir Putin has always been calling the shots at the Kremlin. Cloning has always been a mundane laboratory procedure. Elian Gonzalez, who would like to someday visit the US again, has always been back in Cuba. The United States has always been at war. The class of 2020, they have never had to watch or listen to programs at a scheduled time. Each year they've been alive, the US population has grown by more than 1 million Latinos. If you want to reach them, you'd better send a text. Emails are often ignored. They disagree, and this is one I have a lot of problem with. They disagree with their parents as to which was the first Star Wars episode. Books have always been read to you on audible.com. A Bush and a Clinton have always been campaigning for something big. While Chads were hanging in Florida, they were potty training in all 50 states. John Elway and Wayne Gretzky have always been retired. They have never seen billboard ads for cigarettes. Airline tickets have always been purchased online. Robots have always been surgical partners in the OR. And Michael J. Fox has always spoken publicly about having Parkinson's disease. So this is just a few of the, actually it turns out, 60 different items. But I think it starts to put us in the right kind of headspace for sort of how different the generational perspective can be. So I have a lot that I can say this morning. I'll give you the top line just to get us started. So millennials are thinking about philanthropy much earlier in life, whether they are entrepreneurs who have started their own companies, employees at firms that go public, or inheritors. They're not waiting until their wealth is secure and in place to start thinking about this. They're thinking about it from the get-go. They're not wedded to traditional forms of philanthropy or social change. Nonprofits, foundations, these are vehicles, but they're not the end-all be-all for them. Their focus is on creating impact, and everything in their lives are blended. So there is increasingly less distinction between the way they view investing, the way they view philanthropy, the way they view business, the way they view their social and personal lives. So just to go a little bit deeper from the work that we do at my firm, and also a really important study that came out in 2012 from 2164 and the Johnson Center at Grand Valley State University called Next Gen Donors. If you haven't seen this report, I think it's nextgendonors.com. And it's a really important study. And the top line findings sort of echo some of what I just said. An unprecedented amount of wealth, again, both through the generation of wealth and also the transfer that we all know, somewhere on the magnitude of $30 to $40 trillion. They're driven by values, not valuables, so they do respect things like legacy, but they also want to assess the needs of the day, and they want to use some new vehicles, although some of the same old ones, to achieve impact. They're ready to be donors now, they're focused on impact, and they go all in. These are people who, again, they bring their whole selves to everything in life, and it goes back to this notion of being blended. So I think as advisors, I'm sure you're already experiencing this, but I think you should expect that you're going to be having these conversations much, much sooner, either because clients are ready now to be donors, or because the amount of wealth that they're generating at a young age means that they really need to start thinking about this from the get-go. So I'll just say two other things and then maybe get to a little bit more as we get into the conversation. One is, I think that there is also quite an entrepreneurial approach that we see coming from millennial donors. Not only are they entrepreneurial in starting businesses, they're entrepreneurial in challenging some of the ways that philanthropy has been done, some of the ways that investing has been done. They're also sometimes starting their own things, whether that is a nonprofit or an LLC or launching a Kickstarter campaign. They are entrepreneurial in I think every sense of the word. And they're also experimenters. And there's a lot when we sort of continue this conversation, there's a lot of things that they're experimenting with. Again, whether it is LLCs, impact investing, Kickstarter campaigns, donor advised funds, there really are just so many options that they see out there. And I think experimentation is just sort of one way to think about what they're doing to try to create the impact that they want to see in the world.
Thank you, Mike. Robbie, Mike mentioned the entrepreneurial approach that millennials take. How do they incorporate SRI or socially responsible investing into that?
Sure. Well, as Mike said, millennials are talking and thinking a lot about how to integrate philanthropy with investing. It's something that millennials are talking about, but I think more broadly, it's something that is resonating with a lot of different people, regardless of demographics. It's otherwise known as doing well and doing good, or what we call it Parnassus, principles and performance. A couple decades ago, there's the notion out there that if you want to invest in socially responsible companies, you're going to have to sacrifice performance. You're going to have to sacrifice your returns. Fast forward 20 years or so to present day, and at Parnassus, we've been one of the pioneers in the socially responsible investing movement for the past 32 years. You know, we've kind of led that effort, and over time, we've proven that actually performance and principles aren't mutually exclusive, but rather investing in high-quality businesses that are becoming increasingly relevant through the products or services that they offer, run by good management teams that also are great corporate citizens, whether it's a terrific environmental profile, a great place to work, great governance, that those aspects, which oftentimes are not really understood and analysts on Wall Street, traditional Wall Street, don't spend a lot of time analyzing, that those aspects can actually help bolster your returns and make you aware of certain risks associated with those companies that the rest of the market isn't really focused on. And so, you know, what we've demonstrated over time is that they're not mutually exclusive, but the focus on ESG, environmental, social, governance, which is the new term replacing socially responsible investing, something that we could get into in greater depth later, that actually helps to bolster returns. So that's, you know, I think a message that's really resonating not only with millennials, but anyone who's looking to do well and do good.
So do you see a predominance of millennials asking for it or more, or you think it's about the same amount in all three of the groups we mentioned?
I think it's all three. You know, case in point, I joined Parnassus about 4 years ago, and we were managing $4 billion in assets. Today we manage $19 billion. So we've grown nearly 5x in 4 years at a time when in the industry we're seeing more and more money move to ETFs, really cheap alternatives where you can invest in an index for 10 basis points or 15 basis points, whereas our fees are significant, 60 to 80 basis points, so significantly more. And I think it's, so why is that? I think it's two reasons. And you can kind of think of it on a 2x2 matrix. On the y-axis, you have performance. Outperforming, underperforming are the two boxes. And then on the x-axis, you have ESG. And it's binary, yes or no. And if you can have, if you can outperform and have, and do it in a socially responsible way, that's kind of the sweet spot. And that message, as far as I can see, is resonating with retail customers, whether it's millennials, baby boomers, or elders, institutions, pension funds, endowments. It's just becoming a better way to invest that more and more people are starting to understand.
Thank you. So just to summarize on millennials, what we've talked about so far, they take an entrepreneurial approach. They want to have an immediate impact. It's not so much the long term. They want to see that anything they're giving, something's going to happen sooner rather than later. They want to be involved. Millennials aren't, your typical just give money and, you know, I trust you. They really want to stay involved and have some impact themselves and make sure that what they're supporting is going on. They tend to also like something closer to home. A lot of our millennial investors want to invest. They're not that they're not intrigued by international giving, but tend to focus on things that are closer to home, whether it be related to micro-lending, whether it relates to universities, colleges, things that other people, things that have affected their lives. And then lastly, It's a lot of direct giving as opposed to using vehicles. You might see the use of a donor advised fund. It's a great way to have a big impact of a lot of organizations, but they do a lot more direct giving than under the guise of a CRT, CLT, or something like that. So next, we're going to... I just want to mention one more thing. There's a session this afternoon on SRI investing. It's different in that the audience this afternoon will be more, it's catered towards donors as opposed to on estate planning. So Michelle, thanks for joining us. How do the estate plans that you draft for younger clients differ at all from those you draft for older clients?
So from the attorney perspective, this is really interesting, and I'm just curious, how many people here are advisors that are not lawyers? Raise your hand if you're not a lawyer. So that's really wonderful to see in this talk, because my experience is that the younger millennials are not going to seek me out first. They just aren't. Not that most people love lawyers anyways, but in particular, the younger millennials, as an estate planning attorney, they're pretty convinced that they are not going to die. And so they are not going to think about an estate plan until maybe they buy their own home, and definitely when they have children. And so when they have children, the estate plan is really going to be geared to avoiding probate, making sure they have a living trust, making sure that there's protection for the children. And in our practice, we do a lot of legacy giving, meaning not all just philanthropic. When I say legacy giving, I mean a trust that would continue for the lifetime of their children, and it's sort of hard for them even to conceive that one day they're going to have grandchildren, but they can, and they get it. And they get the fact that if they have children, why would you give a lot of money to a child in their own individual name? You just really shouldn't, if you have proper advice. You really should keep it in a trust and let your children be the trustee of the trust at a certain age, or give someone else power to make them trustee, have flexibility. And so the planning that we're doing for the younger generation is really geared around that, is really geared around the children, protecting the children. And the lawyers that are here, raise your hand if you mention philanthropy when you speak with your clients who you're doing an estate plan for them. Do you bring up to them? That is so great to hear, because in my early days of practicing, I remember going to talks and lawyers saying, I don't really think that's my place to be mentioning philanthropy. I'm here to listen to what their goals are. But quite frankly, if we don't mention philanthropy when we're doing estate planning, especially the younger generation, in my practice, that's not the first thing that they're thinking about. But when you tell them, if you don't include something in your plan, then the organizations that you care about are going to stop getting your support, they get it, and they will give. And you asked about planning for older generations. As we get into the baby boomers and as we get older, people are much more interested in legacy, what kind of charitable gift. But even then, it's actually really surprising how often they don't think of it until I mention it. And then they're like, oh, of course we want to have a philanthropic component. And then we talk about the various kinds of giving.
Great. Let's go back to Mike. As we talk about baby boomers, what do you see that's different? What's the philanthropic profile? And how are they approaching it? Any, you know, some new?
Yeah, I mean, so if I were going to define, this is not an original phrase, but if I were going to define millennials as a generation of choice, I might define the baby boomer generation as a generation of responsibility. And I think that, you know, we see, I might define, by the way, seniors, since that's the phrase we're using, as sort of a generation of obligation. And I think we see both obligation and choice tugging at boomers. And that's where I think sort of responsibility comes in. I mean, broadly speaking, and again, I think, you know, it's probably easier for many of the people in the room to, you know, to put ourselves in the mindset. I can't put myself in this category, but, you know, the mindset of boomers. And so we probably understand, you know, their basic life perspective a little bit more. But I think from you know, from where I sit, I think the sort of most important thing to understand is that they really are kind of being buffeted by these two sets of headwinds. You know, on the one hand, their parents' generation, particularly in the Jewish community, is a generation that grew up through some pretty tough times. And, you know, in response to that, and also just the way their culture was built, giving was just a thing you did. It was part of your civic life and your religious life. I think for boomers, they're, you know, very kind of mindful of that, and so they do give. They give a lot. They're very engaged, and they use a lot of the kind of traditional forms of giving. And as Robbie said, you know, they are also I think starting to increasingly ask about some of the new forms that are out there, you know, including socially responsible investing, impact investing, and you know, other things like that. And so we see, I think, you know, with the boomers that I work with, I would say they're much more kind of traditional in the vehicles that they use, but also through the kind of choices that are out there, they're thinking about some of the new things, and they're very much interested in kind of the new forms of demonstrating and creating impact. And so that's how I would sort of broadly kind of categorize where they are.
So Robbie, as it relates to socially responsible investing, do you see more of an ask at the boomer level? And any specifics? If you do, what items they're looking to exclude?
We're starting to, I mean, so the baby boomers, I think top of mind is retirement. And I think they're willing to move into any vehicle where they feel like they can get the best risk adjusted returns. And you're seeing a number of socially responsible investment firms post really solid numbers on a risk-adjusted basis. And so I think that's driving a big part of it for the baby boomers.
Okay. And planning for boomers. What are we seeing? Things that are new, things that they're most concerned with. How are they, are they changing how they're incorporating their legacy and charitable giving in the documents you're drafting?
Yeah, so as you probably know, most of our clients have retirement accounts. And when I first started out practicing law nearly 30 years ago, that really wasn't as much the case as it is now. So in terms of vehicles, we have to think about what to do with that retirement account, because as you know, a retirement account isn't governed by the living trust or the will. So we focus more on beneficiary designation forms and what are they going to say, and are they going to go to children? And if they go to children, there was a case that came out not that long ago that said that when a child inherits a retirement account, it doesn't have the same creditor protection in a bankruptcy court that it did while the participant worker is alive. And that was really a shocking result, because we always thought of retirement accounts as actually being pretty good asset protection, right? But it turns out when they're inherited, they aren't. And so we're doing a lot more with the beneficiary designation form, either leaving it in an ongoing trust for a child, and again, a lifetime trust for a child. But as we heard this morning, making sure there's the right language in the trust so there aren't adverse tax consequences. You do not want to advise your client to name their living trust as the beneficiary of retirement accounts. I hear it over and over and over again, and it's just wrong. It's just the wrong advice. What you can do is you can name a subtrust within the living trust, but you also want to be careful how you do that. You want to first divide it up on the beneficiary designation form, saying it goes equally to my three children, and specify how that works, and then you would say, and the share for each child will be held in, and you can reference the particular trust for the child if the trust has the right provisions in it, the conduit provisions like we heard about this morning, to make sure that there aren't adverse tax consequences. The other really common vehicle is I love talking to a client about charitable giving through their retirement account because, and I just explained to them, if you leave it to anyone other than a charity, that account is not going to be worth the stated value on your statement. Why? Right, because it's subject to income taxes. Anyone other than a charity is going to pay income tax on the retirement account. So if you have a retirement account, and my clients love discounts, it's kind of the way I grew up. We never bought anything unless it was on sale, right? And it's kind of like giving to charity on sale because you are letting the giving it to the charity, and it's so simple to do. You don't need a lawyer. You just name the charity right on the beneficiary designation form. Anyone else is going to pay income tax on that. The charity won't. So it's really like a gift on steroids, really. So I would say a lot of focus on retirement account beneficiary designation forms, for sure.
Okay, if they weren't doing retirement plan beneficiaries, what do you typically see a boomer use as a vehicle?
Yeah, so vehicle for charitable giving, clients like simplicity. And that includes even what happens when one spouse dies. I say, well, are you concerned about a sexy sue for the surviving spouse? We could keep things in ongoing trust for the surviving spouse. And while some people are concerned about that, I find that people, I call it sexy sue, you know, you give something to a spouse, you don't know where it's going to end up unless you have the right protected trust for the surviving spouse that prevents them from remarrying and leaving the assets to a new spouse. I call that sexy Sue. Sorry, guys, but that's just what I do. They're with the baby boomers, and really with people in general, I find that they like things simple. So in terms of philanthropic giving, what I talk to people about most often is actually the donor advised funds, because they are so simple. And so for those of you who don't have a donor advised fund, I would say look into it and talk to your clients about it. It's a great way to give during your lifetime. You don't have to keep records of all these different small gifts that you're making. You simply give a gift to the donor advised fund. Usually you can do it online to tell them, I want $100 sent to this charity and that charity. And it's just a great way to gift. How that dovetails into the estate plan is then you could even leave your assets at your demise and just have a simple provision in your trust saying this amount of money goes into my donor advised fund, and you specify the name of the fund, the account number, and then on the fund document, you specify what your instructions are and where you want that to go. That way, if your goals change and your philanthropy changes, you don't have to go back to the lawyer to change the charities. You just go back to Federation, where you might have your donor advised fund, and specify where you want the fund to go to. So that's a really common vehicle.
Yeah, we're seeing that as well. It's just amazing. I think the Federation has how many? 900?
Plus.
Donor advised funds, people who used to do private foundations. It's virtually getting the same thing done with significantly less cost administration, and you know that you don't have to worry about the millennials or anyone else saying, you know what, I'm not interested, or I don't want to be involved in it, or, you know, keeping it going. So donor advised funds across all three segments, as we've defined them, have been quite just proliferating. As we talk about seniors, it's a broad term because in this, and seniors, You think about it, you have so many entrepreneurs, that young entrepreneurs that are now retiring in their 20s and 30s. And they tend to look at their charitable giving sometimes the same way as seniors do. So let's talk about seniors a little bit, Mike, and let's start with you. And let's see how we bring this all back together. Tell us a little bit about your experience with dealing with seniors.
Great. Before I do, I actually just want to...
And I'll qualify it. I'll say, for this room, 70 and above.
I just want to echo the comments about donor advice
funds.
As I
get older, it raises.
You know, I think there are a lot of new vehicles that millennial donors in particular are looking at. Donor advised funds, I think, is just a sort of replacement charitable vehicle for foundations. There's just no question that unless the government regulations around them change, which, by the way, is also possible, and I think we should all understand that there is conversation about that. But unless they change, this is a very, very clear trend. It used to be, right, that you needed, you know, somewhere at least around sort of $2 million to justify opening a private foundation. There are now donor advised funds with upwards of $1 billion in them. People are fully just replacing their private foundations with them. I see Ruth in the back. I'll say that, you know, Ruth, who I believe runs the Donor Advised Fund program here, has actually been really helpful with one of our clients who had a private foundation, decided that the expenses were not justified. But there were a lot of things that she wanted to be able to do outside of just giving in terms of having a public profile, et cetera. And the Federation in particular has just been, and the Endowment Fund, really helpful in not just setting up a donor advised fund, but being able to do it in a way that preserves the ability that we see for many donors now to want to do more than just give money. And so I really appreciate that. To come back to the question of seniors, I think I'll restrict my remarks to say this, which is, I think what I see in terms of my work with seniors is that they are very interested in what the younger generations are going to do with their money. And there's lots of work that the Federation and advisors, like myself and probably many of you in the room are doing with seniors and also boomers to help kind of bridge some of the intergenerational conversations there. It's one of the reasons that I actually think that the Next Gen Donor Study that I mentioned earlier is so important, because I think there was a big question on the minds of older adults, which is, are my kids going to come in and use this money, philanthropically or otherwise, for something that I just don't understand or agree with? And I think one of the main findings of that study was that legacy is important. And so I think, you can reassure your clients who are seniors, that even their children and grandchildren, are mindful of legacy. They're not looking to get rid of it altogether. For as much as there's interest in testing new vehicles for giving, they also understand that the traditional vehicles that have been used are really important. So that, I think, is just a really important thing to understand. And there just needs to be a lot more conversation, I think, intergenerationally, because for the work that we do with seniors, that's really where we see a lot of concern. Obviously, Michelle can talk more about kind of legacy and Robbie on investing, but in terms of sort of our perspective on it, it really is around the kind of tensions and concerns around what's going to happen with the money, when it gets left to their younger generations.
Robbie, investing for seniors, and knowing that part of many seniors are giving in the form of charitable remainder trusts as a replacement for retirement income. What are you seeing in that area in your business?
What we're seeing with seniors, and there's a handout that you have in front of you. When we have marketing meetings in our office, a lot of the baby boomers, seniors, much more so than the millennials. I think the millennials are, hey, this is a great idea. It's really growing. You know, SRI investing now has hit $6 trillion globally. I want to be part of that trend. The baby boomers and seniors are much more focused on process. And, you know, there's a lot of different definitions about SRI investing and ESG investing and, you know, a lot of acronyms. What exactly does it mean? But help me, a lot of the questions I get is help me better understand your process, because that's kind of how they grew up in the business. And so the slide you have in front of you basically goes into how we think about investing and our process. And it really starts, as I mentioned before, combining both the fundamental side of investing with the ESG and bringing them together. So just to briefly walk you through it, you know, there are a couple exclusionary screens that that we have, which include companies have to have, can't have more than 10% of revenue from alcohol, weapons, tobacco, gambling, nuclear power, and they can't operate in Sudan. So that's, those are easy to exclude, quite straightforward. We focus on companies that are increasingly relevant with wide moats or strong competitive advantages run by good management teams. And so we have some quantitative screens that we apply, such as, you know, revenue growth in excess of, say, 3%. If global GDP is 3%, we want to see that the company is growing in excess of that or kind of taking market share in the broader economy. A quantitative metric that we use to assess the quality of the business is return on invested capital, and that's basically looking to see if that is in excess of the cost of capital for the company, if there's a spread between how much the company is generating versus how much the cost of capital is, that's positive for shareholders over the long term. So we run a number of these types of screens, and then we get to what we call our universe of companies that we're interested in researching. And so from there, we really try to understand the sources of a company's moat, whether it's a switching effect, quality brands that generate pricing power, network effect like an eBay where more buyers result in more sellers result in more buyers, and so it has a positive effect. Relevancy, again, looking for companies growing in excess of global GDP, companies that are taking share in their markets. We spend a lot of time looking at disruptive threats and you know, substitutable products. And then management is the third lens that we look at, trying to understand, you know, why is this a team that is good from a capital allocation perspective, looking at their tenure, their experience. And the fourth lens, critically, is the ESG, and I'll talk about that on the next page. And that really, as I mentioned, is we have a dedicated ESG team that they work in parallel with the rest of the investment staff at Parnassus. And as I said, about 5% of their time is really looking at these exclusionary screens. It's very simple. Where they spend most of their time is in the middle of the page, the qualitative assessment. Thinking through the key ESG factors, governance, looking at compensation, incentives, board composition, management turnover, workplace, is it a great place to work? One of our funds exclusively focuses on companies that are ranked in the top 100 places to work in the country. And the thesis there is that companies that are great places to work, such as a Facebook, such as Google, can attract and retain better talent, less turnover, leads to better profitability, which should result in better shareholder performance. And that's actually the number one ranked fund in the country over the past 10 years on that pretty simple thesis. Environment, you know, thinking about carbon footprint, community, is it a great partner in the communities where they operate, and then customers, you know, thinking about product safety, recall issues. There have been a lot of front page articles recently about various drug companies hiking prices for their drugs overnight. fortunately, we see those things way before they get into the mainstream media, and so we're able to prevent that, prevent owning those and avoid owning those. And so again, that gets back to being focused on those issues before they hit the front page of the New York Times or Wall Street Journal really helps to generate returns. And so ESG stands for environmental social governance. And so it's those three factors that have now taken over away from SRI, which was socially responsible investing. Socially responsible investing was really only focused on the top of the page here, exclusionary screens. We don't want to invest in alcohol. We don't want to invest in gambling or tobacco. And we've kind of turned it over and said, we're going to continue to monitor those and not invest in those areas, but there's a big impact we can have by thinking about the positive sides of companies and investing in companies that are actually doing well by their customers in the community from an environmental perspective. And so, you know, I think elders, seniors, baby boomers really want to understand that process before they allocate capital.
Thank you. Thank you, Robbie. Michelle, so as we incorporate all of that into charitable planning for a senior, are you seeing any changes in how, I mean, how often, what are you seeing? How is their philanthropy changing? And then I'm going to ask you how you tackle something else interesting.
So seniors are actually my favorite category. I should have a tagline, the estate planning lawyer for seniors with loving care. This Shabbos, I'm taking one of my clients to Shabbat lunch at Chabad, and I so appreciate them, and I find that as a category of clients, they are so appreciative because what we are doing for them gives them such peace of mind, and there's so many places they can go for information that's just not good information. So the fact that they're close to us and they will come to us first is just, it's just unbelievable. And I'm seeing a lot more thought on clients not necessarily leaving a huge, large estate to their children, but rather carving out a big part to philanthropy, to really thinking about, because their children are now adults, and they really have a good idea about the children's careers, what their needs are, whether they are hardworking and philanthropic or not, and to really say, I'm going to put this aside for my children, and this, the rest, I'm gonna go ahead and give to charity. So in terms of vehicles, I do see in my office, I still see family foundations. They are more complicated. They do have different tax laws. They are more expensive. But for some of my wealthy clients, they really do want to have their own board. They want to have that control. They want to have their children very, very involved. And so that still remains a vehicle that we use in our office. In terms of other vehicles for seniors, oftentimes they have real estate. We're known as the real estate investor's lawyer, so we have a lot of clients with real estate. And they might have real estate that they would really love to sell, but they have a very low basis, and so they can't sell it without capital gains, and they really don't want to do a 1031 exchange. So charitable remainder trusts are another really important vehicle, enabling them to go ahead and sell it. They get the deduction. They don't have to recognize the gain. It can be reinvested. They still get their stream of income, which is very important oftentimes for seniors, but they also have their philanthropic goal met. So, and then another one is life insurance. Sometimes they have life insurance, but the surviving spouse doesn't need it. And they know the surviving spouse doesn't need it. So on the beneficiary designation form, I see clients adding a charity as the beneficiary of life insurance. So that's another vehicle that I think is often overlooked as a really easy vehicle for giving.
How do you address, and a lot of the attorneys in the room see it, how do you counsel your clients, or how often does it come up? people who don't have children and don't have a large family, what are you, how are you counseling them, and how are you talking about philanthropy?
Right. So many, many people don't have children and don't have family that, that they want their assets to go to. And philanthropy is just screaming all over for that. So we talk about, who are you supporting now? With one client, I sat down at her dining room table and we went through pages and pages of lists of all the charities that she gives to. And then we divided up, well, of those charities, what are the five most important charities to you? And then we said, okay, now how about the second tier charities? And she actually gives through Federation. So Federation was amazing at being able to give us a printout of all of the organizations that she gives to. And we gave away millions and millions and millions of dollars to charity. Federation was a huge help in that. Also, we actually got her advisor that she's been working with at Federation on the line, and he was really instrumental in guiding her. And it was really an incredible dynamic conversation. He even the I'm trying to remember who we dealt with at Federation. Sorry, was also very helpful in, oh, I know her, and for her, giving locally is really important, and so she might want to rethink this organization, and this organization is doing incredible work right now, right in the county, and so we got a lot of valuable information from that. So Federation's been a great partner.
Thank you. And on that note, we're not done yet, but I just want to mention that Michelle wrote a book that's called Create Your Best Legacy, which is in the back of the room, so I want to make sure that anyone who does that, I didn't want to forget. What I thought I would do right now is, we have about 15 minutes left or so, is see, before we recap and do some things, if there are any questions from the room. Yes, sir. David.
Yeah, I have a question for Mike. He mentioned 76 millennials. However, when I think of a typical millennial, I think of somebody who has a, you know, liberal arts degree and is working at Starbucks or something like that. And so
living at home.
That's a great question. I don't know the answer to that. And I don't know that anybody has quite quantified that. You know, anecdotally, obviously, here in the Bay Area, you know, we see a lot of wealth, you know, among millennials. And we know that the generational transfer of wealth, you know, is happening. It's coming down the pike. And so those two things together say that, regardless of, you know, exactly what the number among the 76 million is, I wish I had it, but I don't, it's going to be significant. It really is going to be significant.
And the ages again, to remind everyone, are?
So millennials, I'm sort of roughly saying early 1980s to early 2000s. So 36 to...
Think about the gift that someone made yesterday that is technically a millennial. Yeah. We are in... you have a question? I'm sorry.
I have a comment more than a question. Is that okay?
Yes.
For anybody who does want more information, we have a DAF lounge over in the corner here, and we have lots of information on the donor advised funds at the Federation. I will be there, and my team members will be there, and we'd be happy to talk to
you. You mean I'm not getting paid? The interesting thing is, we do live in a bubble out here. If you look at, I mean, and you've heard it, you've seen the coast, people are moving now. For the cost of living, for those who can't afford to give, that are at those extremes, that are moving towards the center. But we are based here, and meaning all of us, and the amount of wealth that we see in all of our business lines is just absolutely tremendous. We see people, you know, walking into our offices in jeans and t-shirts in their 20s saying, I need to do something. And when you ask them about philanthropy, it's not a shock. And it's not, okay, you're not married. Your parents are doing fine. Parents have their own wealth. You have exorbitant wealth. You have no girlfriend. You have no wife, or you have no boyfriend or husband. You have no children. So as part of planning, you've got to say, what's going to happen? You know, they don't think about death, and they shouldn't. But in the unfortunate case that something happens, talking about the nightmare that ensues, it is amazing how much this generation says, well, you know, this one's fine, and this one's fine, and this one's fine, and my school has this huge endowment. Let's talk about philanthropy, and let's figure out, make that list. And the list gets outrageous. It really does. Other questions? Yes. Yes, absolutely. Does someone want to comment? Okay, people are consistently failing at retirement these days. I was with two gentlemen in their early 70s that have retired three times last night. So people are continuing to work longer. They don't necessarily need the money. So it's interesting that philanthropy will start earlier than doing it when they pass away. So the answer is absolutely yes. You are seeing a lot of more current giving by seniors who are working because they want to much longer than they used to. You wanted to say something? Okay. Another question. Yes, Lee.
Yeah, so I'll just start really quickly. I mean, I think that there is a growing interest and field around impact investing, which I would sort of take farther than the ESG, because it's not just let's have sort of a positive screen, but it is to say, how do we actually invest in things that are very specifically, you know, companies. Sometimes there are impact investments in nonprofits that are specifically intended to drive a certain type of impact. So, you know, a company in India that is, you know, providing solar cookers, let's say, to, you know, to people in rural communities, you could see an impact investment in that, you know, as a particular mechanism to drive impact. So I would say two things. I mean, one, it's burgeoning. I don't have the numbers, but I know that they are considered significant. And I do think that more and more we see that type of investing alongside and in some cases replacing philanthropy. I will also caution, I think some of it's still overblown. And I think we're starting to see a little bit of that conversation come up in the impact investing community. There are some institutions that have actually become concerned even with that phrase, because I think there are, you know, in what Robbie's talked about, I think there's sort of a very clear value proposition at this point for the financial and social return. In impact investing, everybody wants that to be there. But when you're really getting down into what is the social impact, and you're really trying to understand, are the financial returns on par with what you could get elsewhere, there are still some tensions there. I think they'll be resolved over time, but I think we're just as with microfinance, we got a little ahead of ourselves in terms of what the actual impact of microfinance was. I think we're a little bit ahead of ourselves in the conversations, and some of this is driven by there's just so much excitement about new things, you know, and new ways to create impact.
Robbie?
It's a great question. I'd answer it two ways. I think for the best in class socially responsible companies, you do see a bit of a premium. Think about companies like Nike, with one of the cleanest supply chains in the world, Google, Starbucks, you know, epitome of a company that treats its employees exceptionally well. So for those best in class companies, regardless of the industry that they're in, whether it's an industrial company, best-in-class, socially responsible oil and gas company, consumer company, you definitely see it. Conversely, the companies that don't have a strong ESG profile definitely get penalized. A couple examples, BP, for example, you know, the Macondo incident from several years ago, you know, that was something, that was a company that had been on our radar, had an awful compliance, had done an awful job from a compliance perspective and then and regulatory perspective, and then lo and behold, they have this incident in the Gulf, and the stock hasn't really recovered since that. So you see those effects linger for a very long time. Another more recent example, the outrage with Valeant and some of the drug pricing that they've done, and EpiPen over the past couple month or two. So you're starting to see that where, you know, you have Valeant. A year ago, the stock was at $200, and today it's at less than $30, while the markets continue to go up. And so you're seeing investors, you know, provide a significant discount to these companies that don't do well by their customers. And so when you have those negative examples and then those positive examples, it's not surprising that you're seeing more and more interest in this space.
Thank you, Rami. Other questions? Yes, sir. Yes. Yes.
It means people who are not really affluent. There's a mass of them, but they're not, they're almost affluent. These are people whose primary assets consist of just a home and a 401k account.
Yes.
Typically, the 401k account is only a few hundred thousand dollars.
Yes.
They're going to have to live on what they can get from that Social Security during their retirement. They manage it all right. There'll still be a good chunk left in that 401k. It may be as much as $50,000 or $100,000. The question I have is, how can you get out to them? They don't have lawyers. They don't have estate planners. Their company, which sponsors the 401k plan, does give them a beneficiary designation, which they typically fill out in a rather perfunctory way. If somebody can, so my question is, how do you get to them to let them know that it's fairly likely when they pass away that there'll be some money there, and they should think about
There's twofold there. Yeah. Yeah. It's and it's a huge part of the population. Right. So there's two things there, is that unfortunately there's a lot of people in our industry that hold sessions targeting that group, which may be good, may not be so good. The way we seem to be able to, or those people, get involved with charitable giving is something near and dear to their heart. So what I see happening is if it's, as they get older, a medical institution, whether it's a religious institution, like Federation, if they tend, you know, there's so many volunteers from the Jewish Community Federation out there that are touching people in a very kind, soft way. The same thing goes on at medical. I'm the chair of a board of a medical research group, and they do outreach to patients to see if they have charitable. But as far as that marketing, it's mostly through what they read. So through publications, because they're pretty much voracious readers. So digital marketing, that can lead them to sites that talks to people specifically. They'll think about it as retirement planning and leaving those charitable assets. So it's really hand-to-hand combat in that group. And it's left to the nonprofits to have the bandwidth and the volunteers to be able to do the outreach. There's no exact science on that. Somebody had a question. Yes. Yeah.
Sure. So I think there's sort of two interconnected conversations that are happening. There is one set of conversations within philanthropy, driven in part by kind of folks who look at philanthropy from a kind of social justice lens, and kind of the thinking about the deeper purpose of philanthropy, who say that that there's a concern around donor advised funds that essentially they can be used to park wealth in an easier way even than a private foundation, because with a private foundation, obviously you have a required spend out. You can, with a DAF, you can let the money sit there for a long time. And I know that the Federation is really good, and I think a lot of other institutions are trying to do this at not letting that happen, at actually being in touch with donors, encouraging them to give on a regular basis. But there's a lot of concern, particularly as the amount of money that sits in DAFs goes up, that they don't have the same spend out or transparency requirements, by the way, right? I mean, it's a lot easier to kind of hide the source of giving, who's being given to within a DAF. Then at the government level, I think this conversation has started to percolate among policymakers, and they're looking at it. It will be a slow conversation. It's wrapped up in some ways with, I think, a bunch of questions that policymakers are thinking about when it comes to charitable giving, including the size of tax deductions. But it's there. There are policymakers and their staffs who are thinking about this, and thinking about, I think, whether some of those some of the regulations around DAFs should be changed to address some of the concerns that I just raised.
Thank you. And with that, what? Yep.
Hi, as long as I'm here, I have a question and a comment. So I'm going to go from DAFs to IRAs and shareable information. So part of the change about DAFs that's always percolating is, should we have a spend requirement? And no, we don't right now. We can move forward on that. Most of our larger donors, they don't love it so much. Another possible change is that you all know that the charitable rollover was finally made permanent last December. But what was left out was you still cannot roll over into a DAF and have it count towards your R&D. So that's another possible change. Hasn't happened yet, but it's
good point.
In the ether, right? So now that's DAFs taking us into IRAs and the charitable rollover. So there is something new, and if I'm telling you something you all already know, that's great, but in case not, how many of you have heard of the legacy rollover? Cool, I get to share something. Okay, so the charitable rollover allows anyone age 70 and a half to roll up to $100,000 per year to a charity and have it count toward their R&D. That was considered more advantageous or helpful to more affluent people. So another proposal is being floated. This one looks as if it's moving quite quickly, actually. And that is that IRA holders, hard to say, will be able to withdraw up to $450,000. And I understand it's per year, but that's, I'll get back to that. $450,000 in order to establish a CRT or a charitable gift annuity. So it's allowing the IRA holder to do the rollover in order to establish an income-producing vehicle, and that's why it's considered to be a more helpful tool for less affluent people. Now you can say, wow, if I have $450,000 to take from my IRA, they're pretty affluent, but everything's relative. Okay? So that's in the works. So that's my point of information. I have a question, and as Talia mentioned at the outset, and I apologize, I couldn't be here at the very beginning, she did say Federation recognizes that an increasing number of the advisors who our donors are speaking with are not attorneys. 20 years ago we started, and this seminar was all about law, and it remained that way for quite a while, and more and more the people attending are wealth advisors. And CPAs, and I don't know all the terms that we all like to use, but we want to be able to appeal to you and work with you. And so my question
wealth advisor practically get involved in this process to have their clients consider philanthropy?
Day one. As part of a comprehensive financial plan, I think I speak for all of us, when you sit down, it's what we call a full balance sheet approach, and you start with, and it's part of actually even the legal requirement, how they made their money, how they live, how they want to live in the future, and what do they want their legacy to be. So it literally starts from day one.
And that's also why I mentioned with the millennials how wonderful it is that so many people here are not the lawyer, because the millennials are not going to come to the lawyer. They're going to be coming to you, and how wonderful that you're at this talk to really be guiding them towards philanthropy and asking them, what are your philanthropic goals? What's important to you?
So with that, I want to thank Mike, Robbie, Michelle. A round of applause for them. They're fabulous.